I love spelunking. Professional cave exploration, for those of you who don't know. You always hear about the idiots who do it by themselves, which is begging for disaster, but I always go with my wife, who loves spelunking more than me. I got a master's in natural geography, and she's got hers in geology. We've even sold a few maps and surveys to the state governments and universities. About a week ago, we were mapping a particularly deep and winding cave. My wife and I agreed not to disclose the name yet, but I can tell you that it's in the western United States. We'd been exploring and charting for several hours when we came to a pretty narrow passage, and that's pretty common. You have to squeeze through a lot of tight areas when you're spelunking. We managed to squeeze ourselves and our gear to the other end of the passage, when to our amazement, we realized that we had entered a cavern filled entirely with thousands of quartz crystals. The walls, ceiling, everything glimmered in our flashlights. This room was in fact a humongous geode. Not as big as the Crystal Cave in Mexico, but still a humongous discovery. My wife and I gushed for a bit. I called my wife over to look at a particularly big crystal. It was twice as long as my arm. I must have been really excited, because as I turned my feet, I tripped. I automatically outstretched my hands to stop my fall, and accidentally scraped my hand on the tip of the crystal as I fell at its side, ripping my glove and leaving a shallow gash on my palm. I landed on some other crystals, but they weren't big or sharp, or I wasn't heavy enough to cause any damage. Still, my palm was bleeding a bit after my wife helped me up. It wasn't that bad, and after a few minutes, it stopped bleeding. We took lots of photos. We agreed that the room was a huge discovery, and that it would be best to cut our survey short so that we could inform the state government. Maybe they'd name the cavern after us and make it a tourist spot. We agreed it'd be best if we were the first ones to report it, and that we should do so ASAP. We traveled back to our camp that night and drove to a local town in the morning. We called the state's Geological Society from a little restaurant where we got breakfast. And we were the only ones in there, so we didn't feel bad putting it on speakerphone as we dialed. A woman answered. We excitedly told her about our discovery, and she asked if she could put us on hold. After a few moments, a man answered, and we repeated our story. The man told us that the room had already been discovered, sorry. My wife and I remarked that we had never heard of it, and that we were part of the local geological and geographical communities, and probably would have heard something about it. The man said he didn't know what to tell us, and also warned us that the room could very easily be flooded, so it was dangerous to go back and we absolutely shouldn't tell anybody about it, so nobody could get killed. I'm a natural geographer, and from what I knew of the location, the room couldn't actually be flooded, but I thought they probably knew more about it than I did, so I didn't say anything. The man hung up the phone. My wife and I didn't even want to go back to finish the survey. It hadn't been commissioned anyway, so we decided to go home a day early, and we drove a few hours until we got home, disappointed and tired. 2 days later, the day before yesterday, I started getting the stomach cramps. They hurt so bad, I swear I felt that I was going to give birth. And my head, it was getting really difficult to think. My brain felt foggy, it still does even as I write this. I didn't have anywhere to go, so I spent all day in bed reading while my wife brought me soup. I love her. Last night, my wife was at the store getting some extra soup when I woke up from a nap, maybe around 8 p.m. I was making myself some food, my stomach still hurt, but not as much as the day before, when I realized that my hand was hurting. I looked down. All around the wound, the skin was immensely swollen and puffy. I touched it, and pus started coming out of it, like crazy. I'd had green pus before, but this pus was a deep shade of sickly purple. I squeezed, and the pus just kept coming. I started panicking, and when my wife got home about 15 minutes later, we drove to the emergency room. I explained my story to the doctor. He swabbed my wound and took it back to the lab. He didn't come back for a long time. We had waited for 5 hours in the little room when another doctor finally came in to greet us. He told us that some special doctors, experts from the government, would further help us, and that they would meet us at our house. But we shouldn't worry. They had everything under control. We should go home. So we did. The government doctors came a few hours later, this morning. We explained our story about the crystal room, about cutting my hand, and everything else. They looked very interested, and they took lots of notes as we spoke. Then they swabbed my cut with a Q-tip, wiped it on a slide, and put the slide in a little white box. I had a bacterial infection, they told me. A new and unrecognized strain of bacteria, they said. It could still be cured, of course, with antibiotics, the ones they would supply. But it was new and exciting enough that they told me that they would name the disease after me. Then they asked if we had taken any photos of the crystal room, and after we told them we had, they took our camera so that they could study all the photographs. The doctors told me they were going to go back to their lab for a few hours and get all the things they needed to make me better, but they would leave a couple of representatives here to watch me, just in case. They're actually here right now, standing outside the doors. I'm laying in my bed, waiting for the doctors to get back as I type this. They asked my wife to come with them, too. Now, there's one part of the story that I left out until now. My sickness had another symptom. Hallucinations. Severe and inconsistent hallucinations. You see, during this experience, I saw some strange, horrible things. But thankfully, the government doctors had assured me that all I saw were just hallucinations from the new disease. For example, as I was helping my wife into the narrow passage to leave the crystal room, I thought I saw the shadowy figure of a large, almost spider-like creature dashing across the crystals. When the doctors told me it had simply been a hallucination, I told them that I thought it was very early in the stages of the disease to see the hallucinations, since I'd only cut myself maybe 10 minutes earlier. "That's what makes it so special," the doctors promptly told me. "The fast-acting hallucination. It's why they're going to name a disease after you." I had to agree, that made sense. The worst had been when my hands started producing pus. When I started to squeeze, I saw tiny spider-like creatures, no bigger than the heads of pins, gushing from my wound and then scampering away across the table, covered in either my blood or purple pus. That's why I panicked. It was both my hysteria and my description of the tiny spiders that had convinced my wife to take me to the ER. Again, the government doctors assured me that this little event had merely been a hallucination. It was very comforting to know that, let me tell you. Just a hallucination. I think I'm gonna wrap this up. It's kind of aggravating my hand to type so much, and my stomach hurts like crazy right now. It feels like I've got a giant softball floating around in there. And I've been having a hard time thinking things through. So I'm just anxious for the doctors to get back and help me, and my wife to come back to me as well. As a matter of fact, I just heard the door open. I'm betting it's the doctors, so I'll wrap this up. Just thought I'd share my interesting story.